about the fading on that, that you get to imagine it at the end. Hallelujah. Amen. Welcome all of you people tuning in online. We're excited about this day. Are you excited?
Yes.
Okay, I'm going to ask you, why are you excited? The king is born. Like Herod, right? Like just a king. No. I know. Who else? Why are you excited this morning? Nobody wants to answer. That's good. That helps me. You're going to draw the preach out of me because I want to press the issue again today because I'm the pastor. You get to press issues. Amen. Concerning Christmas and the excitement of Christmas. How many like singing Christmas carols about 2 weeks after Christmas? It kind of doesn't work anymore, does it? No, it's kind of... Except for Alleluia, or you know, one of them works because it's kind of like a. But there is a seasonal kind of a catch to it. There's a time to that we worship the King, and I'm calling this one Emmanuel, Emmanuel, which means God is with us, and I want to really emphasize that and that crucial point that God came down, the one that rolled out all the planets, the one that the Bible says he's even closer than your own breath, the one that did everything for you is the one that came down. So everybody before, this is the greatest event or the beginning of the greatest time period that is ever known to mankind, ever. And it starts on Christmas, and when we remember it, we get to celebrate it in all its glory, with all the light, with all the fanfare that we can. And that is based, the more we, I personally believe that, the more revelation knowledge, we're going to get into that too, that we have of what happened, the more excited we get. We just can't keep our mouth shut. We can't, because it's bubbling out of our hearts with excitement and zeal. Now, I would look at, and I've said this before, we look at the Christmas card, and most of the people sitting on that Christmas card don't know what's going on. Is that true? Mary didn't know. Joseph, we're going to read about him a little bit. He barely hung in there. The angel had to kind of tell him, you know, she's being honest with you. She didn't sleep around. You know, don't dump her. This is a son of God. And so... there's a lot of people that made up that Christmas story that made up, but to the understanding is childlike. Because the Bible talks about revelation coming in Matthew chapter 16. Jesus was asking, who do people say that I am? And they all, you know, well, everybody gave us sort of an answer. Well, Elias, and you're this one, you're that one. Then he says to them, he's asking them, who do you say that I am? And they're like, ooh, that's a deep question. And one heard from above that you are, and his answer was far out accelerating anybody else that spoke that day. He had what was necessary to, the Bible says, with this information, you're going to build a church. You're going to start the church. It's built on not Jesus is a baby. It's built on the fact that you understand heaven came down. Everything that heaven had, they decided to give Jesus a body. And he says, a body you have prepared for me. He goes into that body. He becomes one of us so that he could take and absorb the death that we all deserve to die. Take it to the cross. And then be risen again, and the Bible says, okay, all sins are laid on this one sacrifice, Jesus. Now you all, by accepting him as your Lord, you all will be filled with the Holy Spirit, filled with power. You will go around now doing good and healing all that are possessed or infected by the devil. That's maturing the gospel to the point that we become the effective church of the body of Christ. And I know by some of your expressions you're not understanding what I'm saying yet. But that's okay. We'll start out with a babe in the manger and we'll go from there. Amen. Start out with what it says in Matthew this day. Matthew chapter 17, actually verse 18. Now, the birth of Jesus Christ took place under these circumstances when his mother Mary had been promised in marriage to Joseph before they were together. She was found to be pregnant through the power of the Holy Spirit. Matthew chapter 1, verse 18, now verse 19. And her promised husband, Joseph, being a just and upright man, and not willing to expose her publicly to shame and disgrace, decided to repudiate and dismiss the divorce her quietly and secretly. But as he was thinking this over, the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, descendant of David, do not be afraid to take Mary to your wife, for that which is conceived of her is from the Holy Spirit. And she will bear a son, and shall call his name Jesus, in Hebrew meaning Savior, which means healing, safety, soundness, deliverance, and security. I remember one guy saying to me, he says, I've never known that before, that Savior means that. So I have the privilege, when I see that little baby, recognizing he's going to be on the cross, recognizing everything he did is what he did throughout the Gospels was to do exactly what the commander, God Almighty, wanted him to do. He says, I don't even say anything. I don't do anything that my Father doesn't do. Amen? So there is the plumb line. There is what I attain to. There is what I desire. There's way down here is compromise. Up here, believing everything that he did is wonderful. And it's going to do exactly what he did, sets the captives free. Amen? Can I get a shout? Can I get an amen? Amen. In Hebrew, it means Savior. For he will save his people from their sins, that is, prevent them failing and missing the true end and scope of life, which is God. And it's actually preventing failure. There's several times. 2 Peter chapter 1, there's so many different times. Romans chapter 10, verse about 15, talks about if you do these things, you will never fail. You will never fail. So what things do I do that, as it says, he's redeemed me from sin, which is great. Some say, oh, well, my sins are, you know, went on Jesus. No, you don't understand. The effect of sin would tear you apart and you would die young, possibly. You would fail in business. You would, everything that sin is leading you to would happen to you. So Jesus not only absorbed the penalty for the sin, but as it says, he will save his people from their sin. Sin has consequence. That is, prevent their failing and missing the true end and the scope of which is in God, which is basically doing God's will. I heard somebody say, well, we got to preach how hard Christianity is, the old rugged cross. See, the rugged cross, it cuts into your flesh and does all these things. And I'm just like, let's throw the brakes on there, buddy. You're missing what the Bible says in its fullness. Yes, we throw on the old rugged cross in identification. I don't take anything that he already took on the cross. But it also says, take my yoke upon me, for it is easy. The way of the transgressor is hard, according to what I just read that scripture to. The way the transgressor goes, you've seen it on whatever, Google, Facebook, somebody before and after on meth or drugs, how they started out beautiful and then they started getting into drugs and then sometimes they come back and get saved and that. Sin is hard on you. And so the old rugged cross is our identification. It's our jersey. I open up, and it is basically like in olden times when a smaller tribe was being attacked by a group of people, they would just have to roll up their sleeves and say, I'm with the Zuma Zuma tribe. And they're whoa, then we don't mess with you. You're too strong. You're big. So that's it. The cross is our identification in that we in Him we live now and move and have our being. His days for us are supposed to be days of heaven on the earth. That's where we go back to, wow, my sins are all rolled up in Him, and I get to go free from the effects of sin. Hallelujah. That's a great part of the understanding of the gospel. Amen? Yes, we talked about gifts the other day. Let me go back here. It says, behold, the virgin shall become pregnant, verse 23, and give birth to a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which is translated, God is with us. Hallelujah. Say that. God is with us. Hallelujah. If He's with us, He's also for us. If He's with us, He's empowered us. If He's with us, He's given us all things that are needed for life. Here in Kelowna, everything that is needed. I know rent is crazy, food is crazy, everything, but Jesus isn't crazy. Jesus is alive. Jesus knew this time. Jesus knew, and again, you go back to when Jesus was born, what the Romans were into, how they were abusing everybody, how what this government and this government was into, and Herod, of course, he wanted to kill everybody that was 2 years and under. So we have the best of the best right now. It takes revelation knowledge to understand that the name of Jesus is higher than the name of food prices. Amen. The name of Jesus is higher than the gas prices, which are kind of half down at $1.55. But it's still, hello, come on, folks. I know we get around the table with family, and it's all about, oh, have you heard about, President Biden, and, this and that, and Mr. Trudeau, and, what are we talking about? We're talking about the struggles in the land. But we have a Savior that we're celebrating today. We have this Jesus, our all in all, our everything. And if He is not higher, He needs to be high and lifted up. Amen? Psalms 34, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise will be continually in my mouth. That'll be all the time. When you're going to meet with family in the next couple of weeks or whatever, you have an opportunity. They are hurting. You're not. Yeah. They're in distress. You're not. Yes, I am, Pastor. Yes, I am. And we'll pray for that. If you are, we want to pray for you. But it comes with a burning revelation and knowledge of Emmanuel, God, who built everything, whose cattle are running over the thousand hills. He paves the street with gold. And I know right now we're thinking, oh, that's la-la land, whatever. He's telling you he's got you in the palm of his hand. John 16:33, again, in this world you have tribulation, be of good cheer. He has overcome the world. Revelation now is the key thing. You and me understanding God is with me. God is before me. God will speak to me. God will direct me. God will help me. Through the Holy Spirit, He's my comforter, my counselor, my standby, my advocate. He's my everything was given to the believer. The world is mourning. The people before Jesus in Matthew 5 were sad. They were mourning. They had the right to mourn because it was terrible. Their cousin could be out there in the leprosy colony. Their husband could be. Their kids could be up for adoption because they can't pay the bills. It was terrible. Along comes this guy by the name of Jesus. He grew off the Christmas card. That little babe was walking the streets demonstrating to everybody that wanted to see what God's will is in every situation. God's will. And my will I don't care about. God came down. What if Jesus would have walked the streets and says, okay, Rhea, I'm going to put cancer on you because then you will cry out to me more. And Sean, I'm going to take all your finances away because then you're going to get on your knees and say, I don't know what to do. And yet we have zero examples of him ever doing that. Zero examples of him putting cancer. Zero. In fact, I read in James chapter 1, it said, let nobody say when he is tempted, tested, and tried that God is doing it. Because he is the father of lights. So I'm trying to hook the dots. You know, when you work on automotive things, there's always the things, you know, a lady goes into the service station with her car and says it goes ticka, 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 like that. And the mechanic's supposed to understand what that means. And usually they will take the vehicle for a test drive or start it up. Now they have a little thing, the computer, that they hook up and say, in fact, my mechanic told me don't unhook the battery so that that the computer doesn't erase, so that we can actually find the problem, if there is a problem. And so there's easier ways of doing it. You know, I myself too, I have a situation right now where I can identify that problem. There's a little rattle. I have a broken shock, I'm sure of it. And I'll tell you if I'm, I know sounds. I know how it feels and stuff like that. And so if there's something missing in the vehicle, we have mechanics called pastors of cars, I guess, to help you connect the dots. Connect the dots. I want to connect the dots with you today. On Wednesday, I shared how different people were involved in a Christmas story. And I see the older people, they were the ones closer to God, if I can put it that way. The Elizabeth, the one, the mama of John the Baptist, and Zechariah, even though he messed up a little bit with his mouth, they were the ones standing there believing God answers prayer. Amazingly, this is before the cross. They were there and they said, God, we want a son. And a son came. And when the angel says, hey, you're going to have a son, all of a sudden he turns around and says, how can I know this? So he needed to go to your faith classes and understand 10 lessons on faith made easy. Amen. You don't say that. And obviously the angel whipped out the duct tape and covered his mouth, or else he would have canceled out. And I shared how they were honorable people. Then I shared about Simeon. Simeon would go to the temple all the time. He had a connection with God as best as he could in the Old Testament. But he had not just a simple connection of, you know, a baby in the manger. The baby was handed to him, and he says, I see salvation. I see the consolation, which means buying back and getting back everything for Israel. If Israel would have only picked that up. I see everything working out for Israelites right now. And Jesus had to stand back and say, because they said, no, thank you, Jesus. No, I'm, you know, we don't want you. And that's in John chapter 1. He came to his own didn't receive him. Guess what Jesus did? He sat there, shortest verse, he wept over Jerusalem, knowing that if you reject, what did I just read? Emmanuel, God with us, helper. If you reject that, then you're going to eat the bread of sin, which is unbelief, and it opens doors after doors to the devil. And Jesus wept. He says, I came to you like a mother hen. What does that mean? Have you ever seen a mother hen in a prairie fire cover her little chickens? That's the wonderful picture. She got toasted, but the chickens lived. You know, a picture of Jesus on what he did for us. So, don't, you know, I look at Israel, and Sister Billy's over there right now, and all the Jews stand for, and we pray for the Jews, but they didn't get it. And so I look at the Christmas story and say, who got it? Who didn't get it? I know one guy that's on a naughty list. He got coals. That was the innkeeper. When Jesus came riding down the road, the innkeeper made a dumb decision. And what is that based on? What do you think if he would have known, just like the devil, had he known, they would have not crucified the Lord of glory. Had the innkeeper known, he had all the blessings, everything for his whole family sitting in the driveway. And what happens? He decides that there's no room in the inn. And again, commentary says, well, Jesus needed to taste how to be poor. What? No, Jesus was already filled with the Holy Spirit, and he was compassionate without tasting it. Jesus tasted wealth because of what the wise men brought him. Jesus tasted all the good stuff, and he still went to the lowly and the humble of heart and healed the lepers, went to the leper colonies, went to wherever it was needed, that help was needed. And so he didn't have to, oh, this is what it feels like to be sleeping in the barn. That wasn't the reason. It was the innkeeper missed his cue. You think that God, who rolled out The whole universe didn't plan for a room in the town of Bethlehem that night. No, mankind, just like Israel rejecting the Lord, mankind that night, some of them stumbled. The wise men caught it, you know, and they were the smart guys. They were looking at the stars. They knew a king was coming. And another guy that was on the bad list is Herod. Herod knew, I'm going to kill that guy, because rather than having a humble heart and saying there's a leader, no, pride rose up and he wanted to kill the answer to humanity. It's never in government. In fact, I was very discouraged to read what our leader of the opposition, you know, does stand for when it comes to children. I'm grieved. I don't know who to vote for. It's evil here, and there's evil principles over here too. That's all I'll say. We need a turning. There's a Savior that was born Christmas. His name is Jesus. Amen. There's a Savior. And those angels came down with great joy. There was so much joy because they were, that was uncontaminated. When they ripped open the sky and said, glory to God in the highest. It should have resonated in the shepherds. Yes, glory to God in the highest. And from then on, they should have been lit all the days of their life. But it doesn't work that way. I don't read of one shepherd ever opening a church or ever showing up again. So we can all, even if an angel appeared today to all of us standing up here or whatever, we could all, oh, glory to God, what a great service. And an angel showed up in that. What about tomorrow? Oh, glory to God. No angel, but glory to God. See, everybody in the... There's so many. Well, Joseph had a vision of the angel just to get him over the hump that Mary was pregnant. And so he was, what was he? He basically had inside information to raise and protect the answer, the Lord Jesus Christ. Get him out of the danger zone, get him into Egypt, and they had traveled 70 miles on the back of a donkey. That's not too comfortable, but he was because Herod called, they called for a census, so they moved Mary 70 miles. Now, Mary had limited revelation of Jesus, but she still pondered in her heart. Maybe you're at the pondering stage of, you know, well, I wonder what Jesus is all about. Praise God, he's the answer for everything. He's God in flesh. And then he said, I'll fill you with the Holy Spirit. And he says, these signs will follow them that believe. You will lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. You will speak with new tongues. I'm coming to give you, John chapter 1, it says, favor upon favor, blessings upon blessings, gifts upon gifts. And we covered gifts the other week. The gifts that you need to be really excited about. I have given to me is the fruits of the Spirit. 9 of them, right? Given to my spirit, man, so that they totally changed. Change me when I allow. I can be the most loving person. What happens? My faith won't fail. I can be the kindest person. What happens? A person that shows himself friendly has friends. You know, and you're blessing other people. And it just rolls down with blessings upon blessings and blessings upon blessings. Then he gave the ministry gifts. Then he gave also the gifts of the Spirit, you know, which that's selected by the Spirit of God. But we know people that are called of God. They lay hands on deaf ears and ears open, eyes open. Yes, we pray for people generally, but there are those gifts of the Spirit. So the package at Christmas that came through the baby is so much more than worshiping the little baby at Christmas. It's a revelation. God is now down here in us, working, 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 working. Doing, doing, doing. Not overriding, though. Wouldn't it be cool if you overrode it? Okay, I'm going to lay hands on Sean. And he, you know, I'm forced to do it and Sean gets healed. No, he doesn't do that. He's a gentleman. He's respectful. But through the love that we have for him and the revelation knowledge that we are gaining every day, we get to be involved in the Father's business. Remember when Jesus was 12 years old? He was in a caravan and all of a sudden he wasn't anymore. See, they drove Mopar, caravans. you know, God provided for Abraham a ram. Come on now. He drove him out of the garden in a fury. All right. Those are 1980 jokes. But anyways, and John the Baptist's head was delivered on a charger. All right. I see that went over like a lead balloon. Awesome. Amen. And so we have this, I want to go back to, again, what does the gospel promise us? All these people, some of them got it at Christmas story, others didn't. It says here in Isaiah chapter 53, I believe that's the one I wanted, Isaiah chapter 54, verses 14 to 15. Again, I want to know what we're standing for when we look at this baby. And so it says in Isaiah 54, verse 12, "For you shall go out from spiritual exile of sin and evil into the homeland with joy." He said, that's talking about Israel. We got grafted in. So I need to read this verse saying, I'm leaving the world and I'm entering into Christianity with joy. With joy. We can spend all Sunday, Isaiah chapter 60, verse 1, 2, 3. Arise from the depression to the newness of life. Arise. Isaiah 61, verses 1 to 3, you know, he has consolation of joy, the oil of joy for gladness, the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. We came out of something. Why? Because God came down in the form of Emmanuel. God, if I don't know who's running the place, I know God is, God in three persons, but he came down with a plan of salvation, and it's going to be loaded with benefits, loaded with blessings. Give you a moment just to put your hands up and thank him. Loaded with benefit, loaded with blessings, free from sin, new creature features. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. This is a plumb line. Okay, so when John is at home, he would be reading and saying, okay, he's delivered me from exile of sin and evil into the houseland with joy and be led forth by your leader, the Lord himself, this Emmanuel, and his word. So we're led forth by the Lord himself and his word. The two always agree. With peace, and mountains and hills shall break forth before you with singing, and all the trees of the field shall clap their hands. And that almost sounds like a fairy tale. But that is talking about opportunities. Everything's opening up to you. Things are going to be great for you as a believer. Amen. I'm doing this for myself. You guys get to listen. Reset my mind. Reset where I stand. Because I'm not going to go any higher than my last thoughts. I'm not going to go any further than what I actually truly believe. Oh, I'm putting in an hour here for the pastor. And when we get home, you know, we got to talk about the bills and, you know, go to the hospital visit. You know, like, come on. We are children of the Most High God when everything from the world is supposed to fall off. Because sin is removed and we live higher and above. Hallelujah. The mountains are, and the hills, praise God. In fact, it says that in Psalms itself, when you go through the valley of Baca, you make it a well, or you make it a springs of life. It's called if you go through the valley of weeping. See, Pastor, we're supposed to weep. No! He says, you make it springs of life. You can't do that yourself unless Emmanuel, revelation of Emmanuel, like God is with you tomorrow when you're driving the highway, tomorrow when you're at your workplace, tomorrow when you get up, tomorrow when your kids yell at you, today when you're with family. Hallelujah. I want my trees to be clapping their hands. There he goes. Instead of the thorn, verse 13 of Isaiah 55, instead of the thorn shall come up the cypress tree. You know what these are? What is a cypress tree? A fir or cypress is everlasting life. So that's what we're depicting here. Hope or everlasting life. Instead of the thorns shall come up the cypress tree. Instead of the briar shall come up the myrtle tree. What is myrtle? God's promises of blessings. So what are you seeing here? Cypress and myrtles. Blessings and hope. Thank you, Pastor. You don't know my situation. Yes, I do. You don't know my situation. But I got a myrtle and a cypress. I got what I need. Why are they up there? Why would the people have sown, according to Malachi, they had sown these triangles into their garments. Why? It was, the Bible talks about the healing wings. They're supposed to, if you're walking down the streets going to Costco, say, that guy's got healing wings sewn to the side of his garment. What is that for? For your eyes to see it. Oh yeah, healing. Isaiah 53, Emmanuel brought me healing. Yes. I don't have to be sick anymore. Kids, let's dance before the Lord because you're whole. You're healed in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Cypress and myrtle trees. Blessings and forever, everlasting life. Praise God. I'll read that again if you don't mind. Hallelujah. Instead of the thorn shall come up the cypress tree, and instead of the briar shall come up the myrtle tree, and it shall be to the Lord for a name of renown, for an everlasting sign of jubilant exaltation and memorial to his praise, and shall not be cut off. Hallelujah. That's God. Isaiah, Mr. Isaiah, who got sawn asunder, is writing this down here. Wow, they're going to have cypress trees. They're going to have myrtle trees. They're going to decorate them, and they're going to stand there. They're going to say, oh, we got a covenant with my God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. If you go back to Isaiah 55, go back the other way. Here's what he's going to do. Remember, nobody could reach God in the Old Testament. Isaiah 54, verse 14. You shall establish yourself in righteousness. Remember, Isaiah is writing this down so we can read. Write in conformity to God's will and order. So I accept what this God in flesh, Emmanuel, becomes the sacrifice. He took everything I ever did or will do for me. I got to make it for me. He took it so that I have this position now. Bible says in Ephesians chapter 2, it says we are God's poimenea. We are his poem. He gets to write. Your life is not your own. If we no longer ask God, direct me, lead and guide me, we're living on our own. We're not fulfilling the plan of God for our life. I heard that yesterday. Guy says a pastor came up to him and he had hurt his shoulder, fell off a ladder because he's doing all the work of the church and doing this and that. He says, maybe you realize that you're out of God's will. You're up on the ladder, you're doing this, and I know I'm good. I said to my wife, that's me. I painted, you know, the offices with, you know, I do this and that and carry this and that. He says, you're out of God's will. There has to be order in the house of God where all of us are fitly joined together. Amen? What kind of order? Well, the Bible says that the ministers, there was strife in the church. They were supposed to, the Grecian widows and the other ones, one was getting food, one wasn't getting food. So the apostle says, guys, we want to stay with the Word of God in preaching or teaching or learning and prayer. You guys, we're going to select somebody else to run the food counter. So what am I saying? It says all of us are either a part of this here and find our place, be our part in it, be a helpful part so that we can move forward and move on. Amen. Thank you, Tom. We've got somebody else joining and going to help Tom on soundboard. Thank you. Find your place. Let's go forward. Let's not have the brakes on all the time, and let's move ahead with things. Why? Because we are, it says right here, you are establishing our righteousness. I could see the Godhead welcome in you, because the Bible says we're seated in heavenly places. You are establishing yourself on righteousness, right in conformity with God's will and order. God's will and order is that we all bring our supply to the body of Christ and be a participant in the body of Christ. You shall be far even from the thoughts of oppression. Even the thoughts of oppression, when we're all we have to do is fulfill all righteousness, just do what God wants us to do. How does he want us to live? I already read the scripture where it says we are led by him, the leader, Jesus, and his word. Amen? Aren't you glad that we are, America spends more money on antidepressants than any other nation? I think maybe some of them are out of the will of God, even as believers. You shall be established in righteousness. That's not just I feel good now. My sins are covered. Yes, they are. And now, Father, help with putting together those backpacks. I'll help with that. Yes, from A to Z, he will speak to you. And I'll tell you what, there is no answer for being outside of the will of God other than get in the will of God. Why? You shall be far from even the thought of oppression or destruction, for you shall not fear and from terror, for it shall not come near you. I thought the way of the Christian is hard. No, the way of the transgressor is hard. The way of the born-again believer is you're in the body of Christ and he's going to take care of you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Well, just pray that the devil stops chasing me. I can't. There's no prayer like that. Just be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. You're going to win. If you're in the right place, you're going to win. You're going to win. You're going to win. Amen. Hallelujah. What the blessing, the verse before that is, and all your spiritual children shall be disciples taught of the Lord. That includes you, but also your children. Taught of the Lord, obedient to his will, and great shall be the peace. And great shall be the peace and undisputed composure of your children. I'll tell you what. And I know Sister Renee deals with the school board and some of the junk that they're trying to push through. Right, Sister? And I'll tell you what, our children can go into the lion's den full of the Holy Ghost and power. They're not going to touch those books anyways. Now, I pray those out. I pray the school board removes all that junk, and it has begun in the States. You see all over some of the news, Christian news I follow, that wokeism is dying. It was never sustained. And so, praise God for that. But even in the midst of the lion's den, our children will be in peace. That's a promise from Emmanuel, the baby that gave us the cypress and the fir tree. The word. Amen. And everlasting promises. Our kids are above. They go to school filled with the Holy Ghost and power because moms and dads tell them about how great God is, how Emmanuel was raised up and became the sacrifice. And we lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. And we lay hands on people and they are filled with the Holy Ghost and power. I'm telling you, this is real. They're the most serene person in the world. Okay, I'm going to read this to you. That's right, I've taped it in the front of my Bible. I got my love walk here. It says, after Constantine had made Christianity the religion of the Roman Empire, there came on the throne another empire called Julian, who wished to turn back the clocks and to bring back the old gods, the useless bums that are sitting on some counter or whatever. His complaint was, here's a complaint that he had. Why would anybody want to turn away from Emmanuel? Why would they? Why would the government, Pierre Poilievre Trudeau, come into Victory Life and say, no, we're going with the old gods? you know, whatever that is, totem poles or whatever. You know, we're going with old stuff because we came and we don't see Emmanuel. We want to show off Emmanuel. Why would he turn it back? Why would Constantine want to do that? He said this here, have you looked at those Christians lately? Hollow-eyed, pale-cheeked, flat-breasted all, they brood their lies away, unspurned by ambition. The sun shines for them. Not only the cypress tree, the sun. Hallelujah. But they do not see it. The earth offers them its fullness, but they desire it not. All they desire is to renounce and to suffer that they may come to die. See, that's not good. That's not me. I'm picking up the mantle. Emmanuel's going to be my home. I'm going to pray for people. I'm going to, you know, whatever God, led by the Spirit of God. We're going to do this. Hallelujah. Say, I'm here in the kingdom for such a time of this year. As Julian saw it, Christianity took the vividness out of life. Oliver Wendell Holmes once said, I might have entered the ministry if the clergy men I knew had not looked and acted so much like undertakers. Robert Louis Stevenson once entered into his diary, I have been to church today and I'm not depressed. Men need to discover the lost radiance of the Christian faith. In a worried world, the Christian should be the only man or woman that remains serene. In a depressed world, the Christian should be The Christian should be the only man who remains full of the joy of life. There should be a sheer sparkle about the Christian, but too many of them dress like a mourner at a funeral and talk like a specter at a feast. Whatever he is, if he be the salt of the earth, the Christian must be a diffuser of joy. Hallelujah. So today, again, we look, and I can't do it in 30 minutes. We're going to close with this, and we're going to have fellowship one with another. Encourage each other. Grow together. Make changes. Hallelujah. I know I get to change my life. And going forward into next year, change, rising up, diffuser of joy. Amen. And guess what? All those things that we worried about and cared about are going to flee away. Why? Because Emmanuel has been accepted. Stamped, accepted. I accept them. And I'm going to be like Simeon in the temple. I'm going to be like Anna. I'm going to be like some of these guys that knew it. Mary, didn't kind of know what. She says she's pondering in her heart. Joseph disappeared too. What happened to shepherds? I don't know. You know, all that kind of stuff. But, and what happened to John the Baptist? He kind of went and tanked a little bit. But you and I can be the diffusers of joy of the Christmas Emmanuel that has come into our heart. Amen. So for all of you that have never accepted Emmanuel, God in flesh, Jesus our Lord, today is a day of salvation. Today is the greatest day. There is such a joy in the body of Christ. Woo! Hallelujah. Joy unspeakable and full of glory. Answers to prayer. No more depression. No more sadness. No more sorrow. No more sickness. All of that. Please away when we make Jesus Lord. Romans 10, 9 and 10. If you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. Let's do that together. Would you join us? Jesus, come into my heart. Be the Lord of my life. I believe you died on the cross. You rose again to newness of life. I accept you now as my Lord and personal Savior. Therefore, I am now born again. And if that is you, then call us at 250-862. God bless you. And stay tuned for some announcements. Amen.
Well, let's stand. Father, I just thank you for your word again this morning. Thank you that you are life, and life more abundantly, and that at any time, anywhere, all the time, we can come to you, Father, and you're there. Thank you that you never leave us. You never forsake us. Always, always you are with us. So I thank you, Father, that today and even as this week as we go out again, Father, that you just remind us of that fact. Thank you that the decisions that we make, the people that we see, that we're never alone. And we do have the right words to say. We have exactly what's needed because you're on the inside. And you help us in any and every situation. So, Father, this week, I thank you for your peace that passes all understanding. That, Father, today, as even as we stand here, your peace just saturates us from the top of our heads to the bottom of our toes. That, Father, we carry that peace with us. That, Father, we're... You know, when we shake hands with somebody, when we talk with somebody, that we are carriers of your peace, and that peace transcends not just to us, but to them, and brings that life, Lord, especially in this holiday season, especially when we're in those lineups, Lord, when we're going through the mall or wherever we are, that we can be those lights, those carriers of light. So thank you, Father, for that. And just Holy Spirit, remind us constantly of that fact that you are with us. You don't leave us, in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Amen, amen. Well, sit down for just a sec. I'll just do a couple of announcements. Next Sunday is the 24th, and we are having a service. I know that many of you have been confused with however the calendar looked, but the 24th, we have a service. So look at your neighbor and say, we have a service, 10 o'clock. Invite your friends. We'll do a family-type service. Have some fun. And, you know, then on the 31st, no, we will not have a service. So the 31st is no service. We're not here. We're visiting our kids in Dallas. And then we'll resume again church on the first Sunday of January, which is the 7th. Okay? So next Sunday, invite your friends. Family packs. We were able to give out all of the family packs this week. I want to hear your good reports. I know I've had a couple of people text me if you have some pictures. There's only 20 bags left, and if you got the email, I think I said that in the email to you guys. We had 20 left, and we gave those to the Caris Society, Mamas for Mamas, Women's Shelter. We had some gift cards as well. We had, I think it was 25... $50 gift cards because another ministry gave us some money, so we just kept buying stuff. They trust us to distribute it, so I believe, you know, that probably a total of at least 150 plus homes have been affected by you. So praise the Lord. So let me know, you know, send me those pictures, send an email, and then I'll do what I can as well to pass that forward to you. Prayer Bible study this Tuesday is not this Tuesday. Okay, there's none this Tuesday. I think we had that on the bulletin, though, right? Okay, but there's none. So just remember, none this week. That's resuming again then in January, I think the second week of January. Faith is the Victory. The podcast is there. We do have, you know, Spotify, and we have Apple Podcasts now. So if you listen to that, you know, tune into that. And I think that's it. But we do have fellowship. We have some food today, so don't take off. We have some coffee and different things. Pastor's reminding me, offering. If you're giving again online, you know what to do. If you're giving, do not leave without coming to the front and receiving some prayer. Amen? Well, let's stand up. Again, Father, I just thank you for the food that we have back there. It is blessed. It's sanctified. It is good to eat. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So be blessed and go get something to eat and fellowship. Find out, you know, there might be people you don't know who they are. We'll find out, who are they? Where are they from? And thank you for bringing stuff.